Fire in the hole. 5, 4, 3, 2, 1.
I'm Jimmy Oxley, professor of chemistry at University of Rhode Island, and I'm co-director of the DHS Center of Excellence in Explosives. Center of Excellence is not only involved in research, but doing public service. So some of our biggest service outputs are working with law enforcement agencies. So we began working dog training aids, and we're still working that. What you saw demonstrated for popular science was indeed a demonstration, but not being one to waste time or money, we were also doing a real test. So we were trying out our material for the first time to see if the dogs could detect our pseudo-explosive just like they could detect the real explosive, and it worked. We were really excited because that was a first-time run where we had the dogs testing both. We work a lot in helping the various companies that are in the business of doing detection. This particular company actually applies a heat gun. It's a modified hair dryer they were using when we saw it to induce a thermal difference, because your skin would heat up differently than any kind of object you had on your body. And that was the question this particular company came to us with, is could our technique have detected the underwear bomber? We're often an independent, in-between lab for in-house testing, and before you go to TSL or to the Navy for testing, you'll come to URI first. In forensic science, which we run here at University of Rhode Island, we have a principle called Lockhart's principle, which is for every contact, there's a trace, there's an exchange of material. And that certainly happens in bomb making.
You turn the lights off and you hit it with this UV cannon effect behind us there, and right. You can see all the dye residue. And so you can look around and see where, like, you know, where they made a mess. If you were walking into a place and saying, like, I think somebody's been making a bomb here, where would you look for traces of explosives?
So in our large funded study on making bombs, the folks could try to be clean. When we told them try to be clean, they were actually messier. The students could go to the beach and do whatever you do at the beach and still come home contaminated with bomb residue. And they tracked it back to their dorms and to their friends in various places. It was quite interesting. What we did at Alton Jones was purely a demo. The parameters were we needed a nice fireball that lasted a long time and wasn't dangerous for our students to be in the
picture. 3, 2, 1.
In real life, dust explosions are accidental events, and they typically happen with dusts that have a fairly high calorie content. And we even had a query from law enforcement last year about whether it was possible to have a dust explosion with baby powder. You might have gathered, we try to do science every day, even when we're doing demos for folks. The work wouldn't get done without the students, but it's more than just the hands-on. You need that interaction with colleagues to advance, period. It's a very active field. They like to tease me and say, it takes a little longer to graduate here, but we don't waste the time looking for a job afterwards.
One! Oh! Yeah!